Welcome, my name is Myron Grigg. This is a tutorial video and is a conglomeration of photos, texts, videos, etc. So you can peruse at your leisure and stop at any stage to study the photos and develop your future techniques.
You will have completed preparation of your two fathoms of line with suitable common whippings in the ends. So now it's time to move on to actually do some knot tying. You have already had a look at the handbook and that there are very many types of knots. The plan in this video is just to show some of the basic knots. The first of which is the thumb knot or overhand knot. This is a very simple knot, however, it's most useful and versatile and has incorporated many other knots during their construction. Uses for this knot, simple uses as a stopper knot, in other words, to stop a line running through a block. A good example on the ship is the Gantland, which runs from port to starboard and has a thumb knot about three fathoms from each end to stop the line, if let go on one side, running up and through the block at the masthead and crashing to the deck. Another use would be to make a man rope. In other words, if you tie a series of overhand knots in the line, it will provide grip for a man rope. And another use, which would only be for short term, is to actually tie a thumb knot in the end of the rope should it not be suitably whipped, and to stop the lays unravelling. So after you've mastered this successful piece, have a look at the following slides and pictures. At the many uses, you'll see how the thumb knot can become a thumb bend by joining ends, or a hitch when made fast around something. It can be a slippery hitch or a fixed hitch. But the main thing is to now go and have a look at these different pictures and have a practice. To finish this section for now, we will do a marlin spike hitch, or you could use a fit or anything for this, but the idea is to be able to secure it to a line or lashing or seizing to haul it taut, give you more purchasing power. It's sort of like a thumb knot, and you turn it over, under, and put the spike in it, draw it taut, and it gives you power or a good grip to haul on a line, whether it be seizing, whipping or whatever. So this is a good one to stick in your library. We'll now come to the end of this section and have a pause and practice. Now to our next knot. This time we'll have a look at the figure of eight knot. This is similar in purpose to the thumb knot, except a bit bulkier and easier to untie once it's been stressed. Yachties will be familiar with this one, as all our sheets have a figure of eight in the end of them, so they won't feed through the blocks on deck. So simply just lay the light down and weave it around, and you have something that is very similar to an eight. So drawn up the bulkier stopper knot. It can be also used as a bend to join ends. In this case, you tie your first knot, and the line you are joining to it comes in and follows the original one around. And draw it up. This becomes a very secure knot. If it's in a critical situation, as with another knot you will see later, the ends could be seized to the standing part, so that you haven't got loose ends flopping around. Another use for the figure of eight is to make a loop, a running loop. You could also make a fixed loop by first of all tying your figure of eight and then the other part of the loop as before, follow it around. Thus you've formed a fixed loop.
Now that you have completed and watched the video, these diagrams make the operation a little clearer. You'll note a single cord is being used as against two cords.
On which
two cords mean that you're effectively doing two whippings at the same time.
For example, in our ship, if we bundle up a parcel of sails or pass a gasket around a sail, such as the spanker, when you wish to secure it to the boom.
All the lines on the ship should look.
If used as a last resort for a bend, the end should be seized to the standing part. Value as a gasket is that it can be untied by just pulling the running end. So to tie it, the knot, you do so, and then
we will start the next session with theory and
so
some terminology.
Noting
get your
that
lines around.
The running ends come out on the same side.
Move on to the practical
of
application.
The knot.
First,
as mentioned before, if you do unfortunately use this as a bend joining ends, a seizing should be placed at both of these points. Otherwise, one may catch and the knot can capsize and fall apart. It's a danger. If improperly applied, it could turn out as a granny knot. Which is such, and that can, as you can see, can just pull apart without warning. So, reef knot, bearing has to bear on a surface to keep it secure. To undo it, all you have to do is pull that, and then it will just slide out. If you improperly do it improperly, and end up with a granny knot, in other words, these two ends come out on different sides, when you put a load on it, it'll just pull apart. We'll now look at bending two lines together of different diameter. These are known as sheet bends, and first of all we'll look at the single sheet bend, then the double sheet bend. So you've got a line, a heavy line, and you wish to attach this lighter line to it. So it's a case of creating a bend, passing the lighter line through it, around, and back through, thus creating the sheet bend. If this joint involved a line that was going through a lot of vibration or loosening and slackening, it would pay to put a seizing here and seize those together as well. A more secure way of using a sheet bend is the double sheet bend. Again, do your first loop, but then go around the second loop, and if you're really in doubt, you could put a third loop in, or as many as you like. Again, if the line is likely to undergo vibration or slackening and tightening, just seize the ends to the standing parts. As I mentioned, this is ideal for bending two lines together. If you are going to use the same diameter, no problem, just around and back again, exactly the same. The sheet bend is also a good method of attaching a line to an eye, in which case you then just go through, around, and back. If it's a large eye and there's any doubt, you can always go around twice or thrice to secure it to the eye. Now, go and have a little bit of a practice.
We are now going to look at what could be considered as binding knots, that is, holding things together. The first is the clove hitch, which is applied by passing round the objects or spar up through the middle and drawing it up. This hitch relies on tension and friction, but is not a good holder, especially in a situation like this where you've got a spar and a large diameter rope, so it can tend to come loose once a load is released or moves. However, it is a suitable knot if you were wanting to do a temporary hold on
pause and practice.
Say a bunch of on a rope before you cut it. You put the hitch on. In this case, being of a smaller diameter, and if you give yourself enough material, and draw it taut, it will hold. However, not a really secure hitch, purely a temporary arrangement. The one on the end is a constrictor, which we'll have a look at next. A constrictor hitch, once applied and been subjected to load, is a very difficult hitch to undo, if not impossible, generally resorting to a knife. So the hitch works similar to a clove hitch to start with, and then you take the running end and pass it through like so. Draw it up taut. As you draw it up, a load is exerted by this section of the line bearing down underneath. Therefore, the tighter you pull it, the more the pressure, and as I said before, probably means you have to resort to cutting it off. It is very good though for securing the end of a line before it's cut and before you have time to put a proper whipping on the end of the line. This line has a constrictor applied to it, so it's a case of around, as with the clove hitch, and then take the running end, pass it under there, and put some load on it. There's no way that will come undone. And I say the more pressure you put on here, and the firmer it holds. This knot can also be, if I can undo it, I gotcha. This can be made more secure by passing that one around twice before going under there and through. Thus, you've got two lines going over the top, and that once a sufficient layer is put on there, it's definitely a permanent type of binding. I'd recommend you commit this type of knot to memory, because it'll come in very handy later when you come to do the splicing and you've got three of these strands in the air. You can put a strangler on each one to keep all the fibers permanently in place while you do the splicing. So learn this one. Now we are going to have a look at a couple of methods of securing a line to a spar or object. And there are many others, but we'll just concentrate on two at this stage. The first is the round turn and two half hitches. Place the line over one turn and two half hitches. One, two. You will notice that this is actually putting a clove hitch around the standing part. As mentioned before, a lot of knots are made up of several other individual knots to achieve a result. If this is going to be left unattended or is a bit unstable, it pays to put a seizing around here to hold them together. Our next one is commonly known as the fisherman's bend and is a secure way of doing a round turn and two half hitches to a spar or a ring, maybe an anchor ring, in which case this time your first turn goes between or under the turn like so, and subsequent hitches go the same way as before. This is a far secure way of attaching a line to a spar and, as I mentioned, a ring. The load, when applied to the standing part, squashes down on this turn, thus making it more secure. Again, if it was for an anchor or something similar, you would definitely put a seizing around here.